Hello, my name is Linus Zoll and I'm a freelance 3D artist working in the advertisement industry. In this tutorial, I am going to show you how to create a surreal and dreamy looking scene using Cinema 4D and Octane Render. Let's get started! This tutorial is split into four parts with two chapters each. We are recreating the scene completely step by step. So we start with the idea, then we are creating the landscape, working on the interior, and then we are finalizing our scene. So before going into Cinema 4D, we need a concept first. For this scene, I have found my inspiration very quickly. I'm from Germany and here we usually don't have AC units in our flats, at least I don't know anyone who got one. And while I'm recording this, it's summer and it's extremely hot, so I'm always dreaming about colder temperatures. So I thought, why not create a scene that combines the feelings of a hot summer and a chilly room to be in. So we want to create a scenery that contains elements our brain can connect to and know what they are, but with an unrealistic twist that gives us a dreamy feeling. In my case, I have decided to use a very common looking bed as a key element. The dreamy part comes in when we are looking at the snow and ice in the desert environment. I have also tried to give the architecture a more crazy feel by designing the ceiling in its wavy pattern. It's important that we keep it simple and don't go too crazy. By doing this, we make it easier for our image to give relaxing feelings to the viewers. So let's talk about the assets we are going to use. Usually when working on my own projects, I like to model everything by myself, but to save some time, we are using some pre-made assets by other people. All of these are inside the project files folder that you can download. And we are going to use a LUT file by Fabio Siliberti, some textures from CC0 Textures, a cactus by Daniel Hudson, and a bed 3D model by Artem Savetsky. For the background image, we are using a photo by Stefan Seeber, and I also have created a grass model and a desert height map that we can use for our displacement later. Alright, so we are finally inside Cinema 4D and can start creating our scene. So as you can see, I have prepared this file for you. So if you download the project files, you can start using this file. Basically what I did was that I added some cubes to block out the scene because we are trying here to completely recreate the rendering that I did before. And yes, without having this blocked out scene with the same dimensions that I have originally used, it wouldn't really be possible. I also changed the resolution, as you can see here, and we are working in a portrait mode. And yes, that's about it for the scene file. And now we can go check our render settings for Octane. So I usually always have a preset that I use to start with for all my projects, and then later on I edit the settings a bit more. Of course, for this video I'm not just gonna use my preset, but I'm going to show you how I set my Octane settings up usually. So first of all, we're going to switch over to path tracing mode, and yes, the standard settings for these samples are very high. So for the final render of the scene, we could go with something like this. But while working, I prefer to type in a lower number. And if I want to have a quick preview, I like it better to use maybe like 500 samples and then let the denoiser do the work so I can see it more clearly, and then we just crank it up for the final render. So yes, we can also bring down the diffuse depth and leave the specular depth as it is for now. One thing we definitely want to change is just completely set the caustic blur to 1, because we don't see any caustics in the scene anyways, and this is just saving us a little bit of render time. And then of course we are going to edit the GI clamp, because the default value is very, very, very high. I don't know when you would use this value. So we are just typing in the number 10, this should be good, and also activate adaptive sampling. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is to add an octane camera in my scene, and we're going into the camera mode and just try to roughly place our camera. So yeah, it doesn't need to be perfect. I'm just trying to replicate what I did in my original image. So I'm also going to change my focal length to portrait mode and leave everything else as it is. But I go into my composition setting, enable the grid, and I like to change the color of these lines because I think the default color is a bit hard to see sometimes, especially with these white surfaces. So I like to change it to red. And now I'm just roughly placing my camera. We are definitely going to edit this later on again, but we need to start somewhere, right? All right. So the next step would be to start the live viewer first and then try to, yes, roughly place our octane daylight. So first I'm going to lock my resolution here and scale it down a bit so I can see the whole frame. And yes, now I'm going over to objects and add an octane daylight. And I use this a lot in almost all of my scenes, I think. Because it just works really great. In my opinion, you have a lot of settings that you can change and it's just always looking very good in my opinion. So what you first want to do is go into the coordinates of this object and rotate it a bit. So by doing this, you can basically just tell where the sun is coming from and from which angle it's coming from. So what I'm doing here is trying to get a result that is similar to the image that I have originally created. I know that we are later going to change it a little bit again, but this is a good base to start with. Okay, so let's go into our octane daylight tag, and what I like to do is bring down the saturation of the blue, because I think in almost all cases it looks a little bit too bluish, but since our scene is going to be placed in a desert, we can leave the sun color as it is. So here I'm just trying to show you what happens if you change the sun size. So basically the bigger the sun is, the softer your shadows are. For this scene I left it at 3 because I didn't want super sharp shadows, but of course I also didn't want them to be too soft. So I thought 3 would be a nice value. Please keep in mind that for this render I'm not trying to get like insanely photorealistic. For me it's more important that it just looks good in my opinion, and it's just not trying to be photoreal. It's more about colors and the story behind the scene and the composition and all this kind of stuff. So I'm not trying to have the perfect values everywhere to make it look real. So what I'm doing now is just starting to organize my scene. So if you press Alt and G while having an object selected, you can place them into a null object. And what I also like to do is to create another null called backup. And I always have something like this in my scenes and then I just hide it. And I just created a copy of my room inside this folder. So basically, this is allowing me, if I do some changes that I regret, I can just go back and get my original object. So yes, you are going to see me making copies of some of these objects during the tutorials and placing them there. So the next thing we are doing is going into our Octane camera tag and enable the camera imager, and we are going to change the response type to linear and editing our gamma to a value of 2.2. And if we do this, it looks just as it did before we did this, but we are now able to load in a custom LUT without any problems. So in this case, we are using a really great LUT by Fabius Liberti. It's also included in the project files that you can download here. And I really like to start working very early with a LUT inside Octane, because for me it's easier to imagine how the render is going to look like with a little bit of like color grading, basically. So it's not looking as flat in the live viewer, and for me it's just easier to work in this way. Yes, so we can also play around with the gamma values a bit, and you can also play with the strength of the LUT, and you could say that the exposure slider, the gamma slider, and the LUT strength, that these three kind of all play together in having at least some basic options to change the look of your render inside Cinema 4D. And it's not replacing Photoshop, of course, but it's a good way to start, in my opinion. So this is why we are doing this. All right, so let's start with adding some water. So we are just using a plane and adding this to our project. And then what I want to do is go on the options and uncheck check camera. So now it stays the same camera inside our live viewer, but in the viewport, we can just go outside our cam. I know there are different ways of doing this, but this is just what I'm used to. So yes, we are scaling up our plane just to roughly fit this cutout that I have prepared in my blocked out scene. And this plane is going to be water later. So we need a material, of course. So I always work using Octane composite materials, just because I always easily have the option, if I later decide that I want to go a bit more crazy with a material. So I always have the option to just add more submaterials and just get more complex. So even for this simple water material, I'm basically working with a composite material just because I'm used to doing so. But of course, you could also just drop in a specular material, and that's perfectly fine too. But yeah, so we're just adding a submaterial, of course, and change our type to specular. And yes, it's not looking like water yet. So we are going to change the index value. Okay. So now that we have set the index, what we want to add is an octane noise. This is going to give us the water look if we plug this into the bump. So I'm doing a render region here so that all the GPU power only has to render this part of the image, so we can see our result more quickly. And now we are changing the noise type to turbulence, and I'm just changing these settings a bit. So we are adding a few more octaves and changing the omega value as well. And I'm just showing here what this is doing. So basically the higher this is, the more complex it's looking. And if we do this like super low, then it looks very almost like painted. So yeah, we're just going with 0.2. That's fine for now. I want to say that for all of these materials I'm creating here, we might come back later and edit them again. So I'm only trying to get like a good base to work with first, and then afterwards go into some things that I'm not happy with and do some more edits. Okay, so as you can see, I added a transform node and I'm just trying to roughly get a similar looking shape as I did in my original render. So I think this is looking good for now. We can of course always go back later and make some final edits, but for now I first want to introduce some color. So I am going to add an RGB spectrum and pick a nice blue. And then we put this into the transmission, and as you can see, it's way too saturated. So I'm going to bring this down something like 10%. Yeah, this is looking better already. At least for the style that I'm going with. See you in the next chapter.